The University of California, San Diego, is one of the world's leading public research universities. Its campus is comprised of seven colleges, starting in 1964, and has been expanding ever since. We can see the grounds are being worked on shortly after the commencement ceremonies concluded on the fields below. UCSD is home to the Stuart Collection. It was started in 1981 and extends the feeling of community and campus life. We'll see many of the sculptures in the collection and a few other interesting places here at UCSD. Sojourner Truth was born into slavery as Isabella Baumfree in 1797. At the age of 9, she was sold with a flock of sheep for $100. In 1826, she escaped slavery with her infant daughter, and 2 years later, was one of the first black women to win a court lawsuit against a white man to get her enslaved son back. In 1843, she changed her name to Sojourner Truth, traveling the country and preaching for women's rights and the abolition of slavery. She became the first African-American woman to have a bronze bust honoring her in the United States Capitol building. Here is a bust of Thurgood Marshall, the first African-American Supreme Court justice and namesake for the third college at UCSD. He watches over some structures, like the Social Sciences Public Engagement Building and the Catalyst, built here in 6th College at UCSD. Hidden behind the reflections of the Genie Auditorium glass is a 22 by 62 foot mural titled Same Old Paradise. It has a snake referencing the Garden of Eden, which turns into a road. There is a tiled collage with lines from On the Road by Jack Kerouac. The orange groves have a five-point perspective, yielding a feeling of motion. The mural was a temporary installation in 1987 at the Brooklyn Museum and was stored in a crate for 30 years. In the same way it references On the Road, this mural traveled on the road to California for its revival here at UCSD. Under the tamarack apartments of Muir College lies this granite green table. It's about the size of a large banquet table and has short poems and phrases inscribed into its surface and benches. Some are encouraging, such as push yourself to the limit as often as possible, or selflessness is the highest achievement. Others are thought-provoking, stating, there's nothing except what you sense. The green table is available for anyone to sit, eat, or study while contemplating the texts written upon it. In the trees between Mandeville Center and the Library Walk, you'll come across these blue screens that look like giant nets for a tennis court. Two running violet V-forms is artwork meant to be influenced and partly concealed by its environment. Each individual person will have a different perspective and see different parts of the piece at any given moment. It's amazing these forms have stood for nearly 40 years without causing hindrance to the surrounding nature. Within the cellular and molecular medicine facility is a central area paved with a red and black slate design set into gravel. This piece is simply titled Terrace and has benches and a table for people to rest or gather their thoughts. Australian willow trees line the outer edge and provide some shade from the sun. Humans have invented ways to communicate over long distances, including smoke signals, carrier pigeons, the postal service, and flag semaphore. What we know today as instant messaging, or texting, has its origins tied to May 24, 1844. In the year prior, Samuel Morse and Alfred Vail secured funding from Congress to build a 40-mile electric telegraph line from Washington, D.C. to Baltimore, Maryland. The first electric telegraph message was sent on that wire in May of 1844. Of the small group present, the patent commissioner's 18-year-old daughter Annie suggested a quote from the Bible, "What hath God wrought?" Morse sent the message to Alfred Vail in Baltimore, who replied in kind just after receiving it. Here is a personal souvenir of the same message sent the next day from Vail to Samuel Morse. "What hath God wrought?" is the title of this 199-foot tower with an LED lantern on top. It constantly flashes out that first message through Morse code. Its height was made as high as the law would allow, and it towers over Urey Hall, where the annual watermelon drop is performed on campus. The tower shows how far we have advanced in technology and communication, and what we can accomplish in the future. At the southern end of the oldest college on campus, Revell College, is this group of gray granite blocks. Their arrangements refer to architectural structures such as posts, columns, windows, doorways, and thresholds. La Jolla Project, built in 1984, has forms that can be seen in Stonehenge, although this may not be intentional. The latter site in England was established over 5,000 years ago and was created in stages over the course of 1,500 years. Carhenge in Nebraska more closely matches La Jolla Project in terms of timeline. The two were both completed in the 1980s. La Jolla Project is modestly titled and has more straight lines than either of these two. It is interesting to see how it interacts with the surrounding landscape. It is also satisfying to note something with simple structure and lines can lie in the same area as a complex building being constructed in the background. The La Jolla Project stands as an indicator of what has been achieved before and of progress yet to be made. In the southernmost eucalyptus grove next to the Mandel Weiss Theater is an invisible piece of art that cannot be seen. Listen to the trees. Can you hear it? There are 32 wind sensors and 32 loudspeakers which produce pitches based on the wind passing through the trees. The wind garden produces tones of the harmonic series during the day and tones of the subharmonic series at night. In other words, there are additional notes that make the timbre of a guitar sound like a guitar, or a flute sound like a flute. It even applies to the human voice. Tuvan throat singers, or overtone singers, are able to control the volume of their harmonics by changing the shape of their throat or tongue. One person sings two notes simultaneously. Here's an overtone sample sung by Anna Maria Heffele.
Ooh.
in an adjacent grove of eucalyptus trees. You'll see this bright red object on the left, just off the walking path. It's a giant red shoe with a yellow shoelace and a green eyelet. The red shoe is made out of laminated wood and painted to stand out against its background. Shoes come in pairs. Where is the other one? As a lone shoe is often buried at the back of a shoe closet, this location is one of the most remote areas of the UCSD campus. Foot traffic is very rare here, but for those who do pass by, they know the existence of a secluded piece of artwork in the Stuart Collection. Most scenic views are of the ocean. The La Jolla Vista view overlooks all the roads and buildings southeast of UCSD. The panoramic bronze map lets us look back in time how everything appeared in 1987. You can see the Mormon temple just on the other side of the 5 freeway. Closer inspection of the bronze map show the area was developed, but much has changed over 3 decades. A telescope is here. What can we see looking through? Mostly a Swinerton crane, reminding us that change and progress is all around. La Jolla Vista View lies just behind the La Jolla Playhouse on campus. On the lawn next to the Mandeville Auditorium stands the first sculpture in the Stuart Collection. It's a 14-foot bird that stands atop a 15-foot archway. It's titled Sun God. It was created by Nikki de Saint-Phal. Her works are featured in many public places around San Diego. This was her first major work commissioned in the United States. Find out more about Nikki de Saint-Phal by searching for and watching the San Diego review of the Embarcadero after this one. When the sun god first arrived, students placed a giant egg under the archway with the message, "Happy Birthday." It remains very popular with the students, and UCSD celebrates an annual festival named after the sun god. The festival was first held surrounding the sun god, but quickly outgrew the area. It's now held at the athletic fields in the north of campus. The sun god has seen 4 decades of UCSD students earning their degrees. Despite all the changes and construction on campus, it will keep watch over the years for generations to come. Next to the School of Medicine is another artwork placed in the middle of a walkway. As we come closer to it, we see it's the trunk of a eucalyptus tree with a figure standing on top. This piece called Standing is not just a sculpture, but also a fountain. The water that resides at the roots of the tree travels up the trunk and comes flowing out of the figure's hands. The intent is to show that our bodies are vehicles for fluid, and as such, our life force itself flows through our bodies. On the torso of the figure are little starfish pins, arranged according to the star constellation Virgo. Water is the source of all life, and its sound somehow has a cleansing effect on our minds. This fountain is quite appropriate in the middle of the medical school courtyard. In early 2022, Rupertus Lane was closed off to vehicles to further pedestrian and micromobility travel near the campus center. Students painted the street in UCSD's school colors of blue and gold, with some cyan accents. Right next to Rupertus Lane is this stone slab with a plaque that is very easy to walk by and miss. It is a memorial marker for Camp Matthews, a 574-acre U.S. Marine Corps rifle marksmanship training facility. Part of it was situated where Revell College and the VA Hospital currently reside. The camp was established during World War I and expanded during World War II. By the mid-1950s, it had 6 rifle ranges, 1 range for mortars, grenades, flamethrowers, and bazooka, 3 small bore and school ranges, and a single range each for pistols and skeet shooting. The camp had a chapel, a combat training pool, a gymnasium, a large mess hall, and a bowling alley. The 7 barracks and 270 tents saw over 1 million Marines attain their marksmanship training at a rate of 9,000 Marines every 3 weeks. In 1964, the land was deeded to the University of California, and Marine Corps rifle training continued at Camp Pendleton up north. Triton is the son of Poseidon and Amphitrite. He is a merman with the torso of a man and the lower body of a fish. UCSD is close to the Pacific Ocean and has history with the Scripps Institute of Oceanography. It is natural the Triton is their mascot since 1964. The 750-pound bronze statue holds a conch shell and a trident. The conch shell is used as a call signal for warning, attention, or battle. The trident represents power and authority. In Hinduism, one of the main deities, Shiva, wields a trident as well. In one interpretation, the 3 prongs stand for creation, maintenance, and destruction. The UCSD Triton normally rides on a fountain of water at the bottom of the steps at Price Center East. Atop the Powell Structural Systems Lab for earthquake stress testing are the neon tubes of vices and virtues. The words are written with 7-foot letters, 7 virtues in standard text, and 7 vices in italics. You can see how the word pairs are overlapped during the day. However, the text is meant to be read at night. The virtues flash clockwise around the building, while the vices appear in a counterclockwise direction. At certain intervals, all vices and virtues flash together. Everyone going through life will experience some or all of these vices and virtues to varying degrees. What is the most common stuffed animal toy? If you said a teddy bear, you're right. Now let's say the teddy bear is over 23 feet tall and weighs 360,000 pounds. And it's made out of solid granite stone. It definitely wouldn't fit on a child's nightstand or next to their pillow. The 217,000 pound torso rock was found in a rock quarry near the Paula Indian Reservation across from Fallbrook. It was transported down the 15 freeway at night on an 18-axle truck with a 4-car police escort. The torso is so enormous, it appears as a large boulder when approached from behind. At least until you get closer. On paper, the bear is a simple creation, made out of 8 rocks. The size, however, is what makes it an engineering feat. How are the arms and legs attached to the torso? How are the head and ears made earthquake safe? A comforting, memorable childhood toy created on a magnificent scale makes a lasting impression on anyone. Bear sits patiently for visitors in the academic courtyard near Atkinson Hall. If you head into the trees between the Geisel Library and the Faculty Club, you may see something different. There are 2 trees with a patchwork of metal bark. One reads poetry and stories, although not right now. The other plays music. We can see the fork in the branches, which conceals a speaker within. Those 2 trees represent loss and displacement. What's wrong with this picture? The fallen star shows the disorientation people may feel when first arriving in a new place. It could mean leaving home for college, relocating to a new city, or moving to another country. It's as if the home has been dropped from the sky, landing wherever fate or luck took it. This art piece presents us with the appearance of a home that feels correct, but a surrounding environment that may be a little unstable. It is a challenge and takes perseverance, but we can always find a way to adapt to anything life throws at us. Fallen Star lies on top of Jacob's Hall, east of the Geisel Library. The Geisel Library is the most recognizable building on the UCSD campus. It opened in 1970 as the Central Library. During the planning phase, the library was intentionally located at the top of a canyon. Even with the inevitable development of other buildings, it would remain a visible and symbolic landmark for UCSD. From a higher angle, we can see the central core, which houses the elevators and stairwells to reach all floors of the diamond-shaped library. Many schemes were considered for the library's final shape. Multi-tower, subterranean, compound, and gateway. The spherical or diamond shape of the library was chosen for the advantages of minimizing vertical movement through a tower and providing more floor space on certain levels for larger collections. In 1995, the library was renamed in honor of Audrey and Theodore Geisel, or Dr. Seuss, as most people know him. At the base of the Geisel Library grounds is a path with what appears to be a scaly tail wrapped around. Let's follow it up and see where it takes us. The path is crowned at the center. Here's a giant book. The book is titled Paradise Lost by Milton, an epic poem which tells of the fall of mankind from the Garden of Eden. If that is the tale told by this book, there can only be one creature on this path. What animal are we following? Reaching the top of the path, we see what we expect. A snakehead with a long tongue. The slate and concrete snake path was installed here in 1992. Sitting in the garden under the Geisel Library can be relaxing. And that's exactly where we find the Cat in the Hat and his creator, Dr. Seuss. Theodore Geisel wrote 60 children's books, the majority under his pen name of Dr. Seuss. Did you know the whole world mispronounces his name? According to Geisel himself, it was his mother's maiden name and his middle name, pronounced Soyce, rhyming with voice. He embraced the American pronunciation of Seuss, as it closely ties him to Mother Goose. The back of his chair has details of stairs and terraces in the style of his artwork. On the table, we see a drawing of a green ham with a balloon, and a note with his final book, Oh, the Places You'll Go. We've gone to many places around the UCSD campus, viewing the Stuart Collection and other things of interest. The University of California, San Diego has many curious artifacts and objects for us to discover. If you enjoyed this video, you can help this channel grow. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching San Diego Review.